A small, brown, ragged, shadowy boy. A silhouette of fun. And a shadow as ragged and slim as himself, a dancing in the sun. It is hard to tell the shadows apart. So into each other they run. As dark and elusive they melt and they mix and whirl as they dance in the sun. No matter what falls to the rest of the world, no matter what's done or undone, so the day be idle and long enough for dancing in the sun, for dancing in the sun. Greetings, and welcome to the second installment of the Convergence Ensemble's American Voice in Poetry and Song. My name is Regie Gibson, and I will be your narrator for this program. And, as you have just experienced, I am joined by two truly gifted individuals, vocalist and actor Davron Monroe, and pianist and artistic director of the Convergence Ensemble, Rachel Goodwin. The poem I recited and Davron sang was created by poet Maria Howard Weeden. Howard Weeden, as she liked to be known, was not only a talented poet, but also an accomplished painter who, in the time of American Reconstruction, created stunning and respectfully drawn portraits of African Americans when few, if any, white American artists thought African Americans were worthy of being depicted in a dignified manner. And we can hear in her poem, Dancing in the Sun, her visual sensibilities and respect for her subject, in this case, a small, brown, ragged, shadowy boy, are present in her writings as well. The music to which Davron sang and which Rachel beautifully played was composed by John Work III. Work came from a very musical family. Both his grandfather and father were well-regarded composers. We'll hear another piece by John Work III a bit later in the program. Next will be a suite of three poems by Langston Hughes, Minstrel Man, Dream Variations, and I Too. These pieces form a vivid triptych of pain, longing, and hope. The music you will hear is from composer Margaret Bonds. Margaret Bonds's opus has been rightfully called beyond significant, and this is certainly true. In addition to her art songs, poems set to music, she has contributed mightily to musical genres as diverse as musical theater, popular music, and settings and arrangements of African-American spirituals, one of which we will bring you near the conclusion of this program. Of Bonds, music professor John Michael Cooper remarks that she was outspokenly critical of society's pervasive sexism and was insistent that gender equality, like racial equality, was an essential task that lay before the modern world. Her own statements in interviews and letters portray her as being fourfold oppressed: as a Black in a white world, as a woman in a man's world, as a Black who composed in the predominantly white social sphere of classical music, and as a woman with talent. Bond said, "If a man were to do this, it would be no problem. But because I'm a woman, men just smile and call me baby. This would be easy if I were a man. But because I'm a woman, everyone tells me I shouldn't do this." Though for a while Margaret Bonds's music suffered in obscurity, she has recently had a resurgence as scholars and musicians have discovered her work and are more frequently playing her compositions and settings.
Thank you. tenderly. Black like me, night coming tenderly.
That last poem Davron powerfully sang, I Too, was written by Langston Hughes as a response to Walt Whitman's I Hear America Singing, in which Whitman, the first poet of American democracy, writes of hearing the singing of a vast array of Americans, but had neglected to include the African American voice. Langston Hughes, as many know, was a leading figure in one of the most fruitful periods in American literary history, the Harlem Renaissance. He was a tireless writer who published in all genres, fiction, nonfiction, poetry, song, journalism, libretto, and even translated works from Spanish into English. What might be lesser known about Hughes is how he would go out on his stoop of his brownstone apartment building in Harlem, sit down, close his eyes, and just listen to the voices, cadences, and conversations of people as they walked by. The final Hughes piece we will present is titled Song to a Dark Virgin. It was set to music by composer Florence Price. Price, a teacher and mentor of Margaret Bonds, met Langston Hughes during the lesser-known but equally important Chicago Renaissance, where they both attended many black salons and social events in which artists could convene, converse, and collaborate. Though being the first African-American woman to be officially recognized as a symphonic composer, much of Florence Price's works, like Bonds, lapsed into obscurity. And following her death, a lot of her compositions were lost. That is, until in 2015, a substantial collection of her works were found in an abandoned, dilapidated house in Illinois. These works consisted of dozens of scores, including her two violin concertos and her fourth symphony. And now, with the rise of African-American composers, classical singers, and with much thanks to pianist and researcher Louise Toppin, we get to experience the power and range of Florence Price's wondrous offerings.
Would that I were a jewel, a shattered jewel, let all my shining brilliance might fall at thy feet, thou dark one. Oh, that I were a garment, a shimmering silken garment, that all my faults might wrap about thy body, absorb thy body, hold and hide thy body, thou dark
Our final art song was inspired by the poem Soliloquy by poet Myrtle Vorst Sheppard. Vorst Sheppard was born and raised in St. Genevieve, Missouri. All of her writings reflect a deep humility and spirituality, as will become apparent when you hear Davron sing these opening lines. If death be only half as sweet as life, I will not fear. I'll shed no tear, nor will I ask my friends to weep, but quietly go like melting snow upon a mountain's steep gray height. These beautiful words are set to equally beautiful music composed by John Work III, whose composition we experienced earlier. In addition to being a brilliant composer, John Work III was a teacher of Latin and history, chairman of the Fisk University Department of Music, and director of the Fisk Jubilee Singers from 1947 to 1956. He was also an accomplished scholar and ethnomusicologist, and contributed many articles and essays to professional journals and dictionaries for more than 30 years.
Shed no tear, nor will I ask my friend to weep, but quietly go like melting snow upon a mountain steep gray.
The final two song selections we present will be rousing versions of two well-known spirituals, This Little Light of Mine, which is set to a score by Margaret Bonds, and a modern arrangement of the very, very loved classic, Every Time I Feel the Spirit, arranged by award-winning tenor Lawrence Brownlee and award-winning pianist and composer Damian Sneed. However, before Davron and Rachel close us out with those, I'd like to point out that no look or exploration into the American voice can be complete without looking at where it came from and what caused it to be. In this case, enslavement, the horrors of our history, and a religious faith developed because of them. For many of us, as for our ancestors, a religious faith is what helped to deal with those horrors. It is what got them through the hard times, a belief that suffering was redemptive and that no lie nor lash could last forever. This piece I will recite before we hear our two last selections this evening delves into both the history and the horror of that dark time and celebrates how a people in a hostile and inhumane situation used the religious faith they were given to survive and thrive. The ship, the darkness, the voice. The wanderer, the Clotilde, the wildfire, the nightingale, the mother of God. The ship came like empty belly. The ship came like a fist in the water. It sails like white knives in the wind, its keel like a cutlass on the wave. The ship was a hard hand chopping a chart through the ocean. The ship was a galley trailed by sharks. Both the ship and the sharks learned to grow fat on the human. The ship was a dance of dysentery. The ship was a cathedral of African bleed. The ship churched the wine dark brine toward the scarred cross of a new country. And deep in the rank and the rot of the ship were the voices. And the voices quivered through blood-battered mouths and lamentations so ancient they had no names. And the voices became the pitch and the roll of water purpled by bloodstorm. Became the sound of bloody water storming against the hull of the ship. The voices became the rattle of chain and shackle masticating flesh. The voices were the child's cry, the child crying as she was ripped from the mother's breasts. The voices were mother's breasts weeping with milk without meaning. The voices were suffocation, breathing denied by the human-made miasmic darkness deep in the rank and the rot of the ship. Yet, the voices called out into that darkness, called above the aches and the rapes and the whip cracks, called above the stains and the pains and the lashed backs, and the voices began to tremble toward one another. And then, all the trembling voices gathered into one voice made of many voices, and the darkness trembled. And the darkness began to be beaten back. And the new-born voice made of many voices felt itself growing, felt itself strengthening. And then it felt the darkness shrinking. The rising darkness and the scarred cross. The troubadour. The salamander, the tecora, the desire, the Jesus. And as the darkness shrank, more voices joined the voice, began to unite and fight against the shrinking darkness. And the voice grew, many voices strong. But the darkness was ever present, ever watchful. And, like any living thing, it too wished to preserve its existence. So the darkness gathered darkness unto itself, began to thrash and to rally, began to snarl and to surge, began rising like flood water. And the voice that was many voices strong began to drown in the flooding darkness. But then the scarred cross began to rise, began to weave its way into the voice, began to strengthen and buoy the voice, to hold the voice up like driftwood that the voice could cling to against the raging inundations of the darkness. The scarred cross, the meeting place of forsake and salvation, the intersected space of earth dust and heaven hope, the stitching together of ancient way and new faith. And this new faith stirred a familiar strangeness into the voice, like a long-held longing newly remembered and moaned in another tongue. And this moan was the sweet weep and the wonder wail of the world-weary heart. This moan became the hum and holler of the holy ghostly hymn haunting the enslaved soul. And this, too, became the voice. And the voice began singing so sweetly of salvation that the voice itself became salvation. Davron and Rachel, please give us the salvation of your voice and music.
Thank you. one train upon this track. It runs to heaven and then right back.
Thank you for listening. Once again, my name is Reggie Gibson, and I am proud to have been the narrator of American Voice in Poetry and Song. This is brought to you by the Convergence Ensemble. Our featured tenor today has been the multi-talented Davron Monroe, and our wonderful pianist and artistic director of the Convergence Ensemble, Rachel Goodwin. Thanks to our general manager, Nicholas Tran, for all of the logistical setting up for this production. And a very special thank you to two people without whom this version of the American Voice in Poetry and Song would not have been possible. The first is Glendower Jones of Classical Vocal Reprints for tirelessly dedicating time to collecting and publishing so much of the music you've heard in our program, and for introducing us to Dr. Louise Toppin, who receives our last very special thank you. Dr. Toppin's scholarship and dedication to the legacy of song created by composers of African-American descent has been invaluable to us and will be to music aficionados for years to come. On behalf of all of us at the Convergence Ensemble, we thank you for taking this journey with us through American Voice in Poetry and Song.